Before we begin today's webinar, I would like to take a moment to pay tribute to the most recent Palestinian martyrs killed by the Israeli occupation forces between May 10th and May 23rd of this year. 242 in Gaza, 27 in the West Bank and in occupied East Jerusalem, and two Palestinians inside the 1948 historic Palestine. Yesterday also marked the 1 year anniversary of the killing of George Floyd, whose life was literally choked out of him by Derek Chauvin, a police officer in broad daylight. Since the killing of George Floyd, more than 15 African-Americans have been killed by the police since then. Those killings across Palestine and the US are only but a sample of a much larger number of victims of state violence. Greetings to everyone for joining us today from Ramallah, Palestine, and welcome to our fourth session of our webinar series of 2021. Where we feature alumni and experts from various fields. My name is Dana Erekat, and I am the Director of Communications at the MIT Arab Alumni Association, a volunteer-run organization run by Arab alumni from across the globe that was established to connect MIT with the Arab world and create a space for collaboration. A special thank you today to Noura Erekat for helping us in organizing this webinar, as without her, this would not have been possible. Over the past month, the world watched as Palestinians rose in unison across geographies, from Jerusalem to Gaza to the West Bank to 1948 historic Palestine and all the way across world cities. Palestinians and their allies raised their voices, demanding an end to the Israeli occupation and justice and freedom for Palestinians from the river to the sea. And I must point out here that the phrase "from the river to the sea" is not an anti-Semitic call for the throwing out of Jews, but rather a call for the freedom and equality of Palestinians who already are living from the river to the sea. While what we have witnessed in terms of shape or scale of these uprisings we had not seen since the 1936 Great Palestinians Revolt against the British, the struggle for liberation for Palestinians has been ongoing since 1948. The Sheikh Jarrah evictions that played a major role in the new wave of protests are not recent nor new and are not confined only to the area of Sheikh Jarrah. The attacks on religious sites such as Al-Aqsa Mosque are recurrent practices by the Israeli occupation. And Gaza has been under complete siege and blockade since 2007. These are all just symptoms of the broader Israeli settler colonial project. What is new, however, is the global solidarity Palestinians have garnered during this period and the international wide coverage of the events. The Black Lives Matter movement also issued a statement of solidarity with the Palestinian people during this time. And BLM activist Sean King said on one of his podcasts, and I quote, "The Palestinians experience a brutality from police and the military very much akin to what African Americans experience in the United States," end quote. I personally recall working in a dark room in San Francisco back in 2002, developing prints that I had taken in Gaza back then. And for those of you too young to recall the non-digital age, I am referring to developing prints of 35 millimeter films, where you stand in a dark room over a tray with chemicals as your image begins to show. And so as I stood above my tray, while the image from Gaza began to appear, a Black man standing next to me working on his prints glanced over and exclaimed, "What ghetto is that from?" When I answered that that was Gaza, Palestine, he had no idea what was happening there. This was a time before social media. And all he said in answer to me was, "This looks just like the ghetto I grew up in." So this man was able to make the connection based on a single image and the physical space that it represents. Decades of anti-Palestinian and anti-Black violence are at the core of the US and Israel's foundations. From the founding fathers of these countries, to policies, to regulations, to urban design, to police trainings, all the way to the ways in which violence and drugs are pushed into our communities. The parallels between the two are numerous. While we will not be able to cover the multi-layered similarities of all of them during this 1 hour webinar, we will have a conversation about solidarity that is more pertinent today than ever. exploring the historical context of the systematic racism inherent in the Israeli occupation in Palestine and anti-Blackness in the US, and the similarities of both countries' colonial histories and what joint solidarities can be built are all key for liberation movements to succeed. This webinar will last for about an hour. I will begin by introducing our speakers, followed with some questions to begin the conversation, and then followed by a Q&A from the audience. To participate in the Q&A session, please type your questions in the Q&A tab at the bottom of your screen, as there will be no voice participation during this webinar. So without further ado, I am honored to be joined here today by two of the biggest voices in the fight for justice around the world. Joining us from Jerusalem is Mohammed El-Kurd, an internationally touring and award-winning writer from Jerusalem, occupied Palestine. His work has been featured in numerous international outlets. Rivka, his debut collection of poetry, will be published by Haymarket's Books in October 2021. Mohammed is not just a writer. Mohammed has also been a major force in shedding spotlight on the displacement and ethnic cleansing of Palestinians in his neighborhood of Sheikh Jarrah and in Jerusalem as a whole, doing this all while fighting to keep his own home. And joining us from the United States is no other than Dr. Marc Lamont Hill, one of the leading intellectual voices in the country. He is currently the host of BET News and the Coffee and Books podcast. An award-winning journalist, Dr. Hill has received numerous prestigious awards from the National Association of Black Journalists, GLAAD, and the International Academy of Digital Arts and Science. Dr. Hill is the Steve Charles Professor of Media Studies and Solutions at Temple University. Prior to that, he held positions at Columbia University and Morehouse College. Since his days as a youth in Philadelphia, Dr. Hill has been a social justice activist and organizer. He had worked on campaigns to end the death penalty, abolish prisons, and release numerous political prisoners. He also worked in solidarity with human rights movements around the world. And he is the founder and director of the People's Education Center in Philadelphia, as well as the owner of Uncle Bobby's Coffee and Books. Ebony Magazine has named him one of America's 100 most influential Black leaders. He is the author or co-author of 6 books. Dr. Hill holds a PhD with distinction from University of Pennsylvania. His research agenda focuses on the intersections between culture, politics, and education in the United States and the Middle East. I'm truly honored, I think we are truly honored at MIT AAA to have both of you here today. And I also want to thank the audience who have actually contributed to making this webinar happen. It is one of the biggest webinars we've ever had. And the amount of sharing of advertisement of this webinar has been absolutely overwhelming. So I thank you all. And I would like to start with Mohammed here. Mohammed, for those listening in who may not be too familiar with what is Sheikh Jarrah, what is happening there or in Silwan or in other parts across East Jerusalem. So maybe we can start with, you know, a brief history of context of the place and your own personal experience and how it is linked to Israel's wider systematic policies of ethnic cleansing.
Thank you. Thank you so much for having me. It's an honor to be here, particularly with Dr. Hill and with everybody. Thank you. For those who don't know, I'll try to be very brief in summarizing the Sheikh Jarrah situation. When I speak to the media, I always say that the Sheikh Jarrah situation is a microcosm of Israeli settler colonialism. And what that means is that there's an explicit example, an explicit illustration of land theft, whereby Israeli U.S. registered settler organizations, colonial organizations such as Nihalat Shem'on, Atarit Kohanim, Ilad, work together in collusion with the Israeli state, with the Israeli occupation authorities to dispossess Palestinian families from their homes. Our story in Sheikh Jarrah started in 1956 when Sheikh Jarrah, the section of Sheikh Jarrah that we know, was built as a housing project by the UNRWA, the UN, and the Jordanian government. 28 Palestinian refugee families who'd been dispossessed in 48 were given homes in Sheikh Jarrah. And then 2 decades later in the 70s, settler organizations began claiming our lands as their own. And ever since then, since the early 70s, we've been in a so-called legal battle with these settler organizations. Now, it's really important to contextualize this in saying that under international law, Israel has no legal jurisdiction over the eastern part of occupied Jerusalem. So the fact that we're even in an occupation court fighting for our homes is a violation of international law. I will say this. I will also say that the Israeli courts we're in are colonial inherently. They are courts that were built by and for Israeli settlers. They benefit Israeli settler. They benefit Israeli settler interests in the region. And statistically, they don't favor Palestinians. For example, 94% of the building permit applications submitted by Palestinians to the Israeli municipality get rejected. I will also say that two of the Supreme Court justices, the Israeli Supreme Court justices, live in occupied East Jerusalem, which is also illegal under international law. Now, since the 70s, we have lost four homes, Rawi, Hanun, another Kurd family, and half of my own home. And when we're talking about Palestinian families in East Jerusalem, we are talking about families that are multi-generational, that live, that we have more than one family in one home, more than one household in one home. So when you throw out this family, it's more than just one family, it's multi-families. Today, there are 550 Palestinians at risk of ethnic cleansing, of homelessness at the hands of these organizations. Seven of them face the imminent threat of dispossession, including my own family, and six of my neighbors' families and my loved ones and my friends. Since October, we have been fighting this ethnic cleansing in a large-scale worldwide campaign to save our neighborhood and to save Jerusalem in general from the Israeli colonial project. As some people may know, the neighboring neighborhood of Silwan, where 800 Palestinians are also facing the same threat, has started their own campaign. We have neighborhoods in Aysawiyeh, next door also, where Palestinian community growth, natural community growth is stunted by land theft to make room for what they call national parks, which we all know are just, you know, borders, colonial borders in the way of natural community growth. And the examples of land theft and collusion between settlers and the state are countless in Sheikh Jarrah and in Jerusalem. I'm happy to speak about this in a lot more detail later, but I just wanted to give kind of a brief window into what's happening. Thank you.
No, thank you very much, Mohammed. And I think it's really important to also point out here that you have different levels of ethnic cleansing that are happening where the state and the settlers collude. So you have actually laws and policies and regulations that are specifically put in place. So there's a legalization of the occupation. And you also have protection of the settlers by the Israeli force, by the Israeli occupation forces. And just building quickly on what Mohammed said in terms of not favoring Palestinians, we know that, you know, there's statistics and data that 87% of the land in East Jerusalem is actually zoned to forbid Palestinian construction, and only 13% allows for Palestinians. This is while the Palestinians actually in East Jerusalem make up the majority of the population there. So there's a systematic, and I do want to get into the details and the analysis in a little bit after we have a chat very briefly with Marc. Marc, I mean, building on, you know, your history and what you've worked on, and we know that you were, you know, fired from CNN from speaking in solidarity with Palestinians at the UN. And before we delve into the analysis and the links, I'm curious to hear your personal story and for you to tell us, how did you come to embrace Palestine and the Palestinian struggle? And how does that relate to your own work in the US?
Yeah, you know, thank you. First of all, it's an honor to be here with you and of course with Mohammed. I wish I could see him in Jerusalem, but the pandemic and everything going on, it's unfortunate that we're all so far apart. I wish we could all be in the same room somewhere doing this. There's a connection there that I have always found to be helpful when making sense of the world. I started doing organizing work and activism work as a teenager, the first thing that I did, I was looking to my left because I was trying to find the book, but my house is clean and so I don't know where anything is. The first book that I picked up that really changed my life was the autobiography of Malcolm X. I was a teenager, and I read the autobiography of Malcolm X, and the autobiography of Malcolm X is important for so many reasons. It's a powerful, transformative tale. It's a story about redemption. It's a story about love. It's a story about literacy. It's a story about lots of things. But one of the things that Malcolm X exposed me to was the importance of thinking internationally. In 1959, Malcolm X traveled to Latin America. He traveled to Africa. He traveled to the Middle East, the so-called Middle East. And then again in 1964, he returned. And he went to Palestine. He set foot in Gaza at a moment, obviously, where the geographic and spatial arrangement was different. But he was very much interested in the plight of Palestinians. Remember, this is 1964, so this is 3 years prior to the 1967 war. He was trying to figure out how Black people and the oppression that Black people were facing was connected to the types of oppression that was being experienced in Latin America, to what was being experienced on the continent of Africa, and to what he also saw in the Middle East, as he called it. And so as Malcolm thought internationally, I wanted to think internationally because he was my hero. In September of 1964, Malcolm X wrote an essay for the Egyptian Gazette. He had just left Egypt. He had been there again in 59. He'd gone again. He'd met Gamal Abdel Nasser, and he was interested in this idea of what it meant to have unified fronts, whether it was sort of Arab nationalism, whether it was Black nationalism, whether it was Pan-Africanism. He was thinking about what it meant for us to come together. He had studied the Bandung Conference of 1955. He understood what it meant for there to be an Afro-Asian or Afro-Asiatic connection. The Nation of Islam had taught him that as well. And so he wrote an essay called On Zionist Logic in the Egyptian Gazette in 1964. That essay inspired so many people to think internationally, but to have a critique. So many major Black leaders in the first half of the 20th century were sympathetic to the plight of oppressed people around the globe, and when they saw Zionist immigration to historic Palestine, they understood that Jewish people were hated and despised and that there was a need for them to have liberation. But jumping out of the burning buildings of Europe and onto the backs of Palestinians was morally unacceptable for those leaders. And as we learned more and studied more, we came to understand that. And so the people who I was reading, whether it was Malcolm, whether it was Dr. King, whether it was SNCC, whether it was Black Panthers, they were all the people who were inspiring me as an organizer and activist, were saying, yes, we need to fight for Black liberation, but that liberation is bound up in the liberation of all people, right? And Palestine in many ways became a kind of, not a litmus test, but at the very least, a almost ideal case study of what it meant to fight colonialism, what it meant to fight for liberation, what it meant to fight imperialism. And so as they went, I went. And then lastly, as I went to, as I went into the 21st century, I was reading and studying, but I was also on the ground in Ferguson. And there was a kind of renewal of energy and a renewal of connections in 2014, where we're mourning and fighting, resisting the state after the death of Michael Brown on August 9th, 2014. And when we were fighting in Ferguson, we were already 5 weeks into the 51-day war in Gaza, Operation Protective Edge. And so we were looking at mutual solidarities. We were looking at the strategies and tactics of how to support one another. We were getting tweets from the West Bank. We were singing and chanting Free Palestine in Ferguson. And ultimately in 2015, the Ferguson to Palestine delegation from the Dream Defenders, which I believe is the first time I met Mohammed, happened, we were able to really begin to really engage and build in real life in real time and in real space. And so my research, which is in Jerusalem, is actually in the Old City, took me there. My political solidarity took me there, and my commitment to deep reading took me there. And so all of those things made me even more invested in this conversation than before.
So I'm curious, what made the Dream Defenders take that trip? We've had a long history of Black solidarity with Palestinians, like you said, going back to pre-1967. What was the moment? What was the sort of the push for it to happen? You're on mute, Marc.
Sorry. There were a couple of things. Ahmed Abu Zneid, Methad Hassan, they had been trying to organize this trip before the summer of 2014. But once things were so intense during Ferguson summer and during Gaza summer, we were committed in a different way to solidarities, because as Black Lives Matter and as BLM movement is taking place, as the Ferguson activists are organizing, we're drawing from different traditions and different vocabularies. The people we're reading, whether it's Asada, whether it's Malcolm, whether it's George Jackson, they're talking about Palestine, right? When George Jackson is carried out of his cell, right? One of the 100 books in his cell was that of a Palestinian poet. And so at every turn, Palestine was ringing in our heads, but the conversation was more nuanced than it was before. And so we're talking about state violence. We're talking about state repression. And so how can we talk about state violence and not talk about what's happening in Palestine? We're talking about organizing. How can we talk about that if we don't talk about, or thinking about organized longstanding resistance? I mean, you're talking about Sumud. And so there's a way that we saw Palestine as an example and Palestinians saw us as an example and a model. And even though our conditions and our circumstances weren't exactly the same, our suffering resonated. And so at that moment, it felt like an opportune time not to do something different. That's the important part, right? But to renew those energies. When you look inside of historic Palestine, whether it's people like, what's his name? Reuven, from the Black Panthers in Israel. I can't think of his last name, but there were a group of Palestinian Jews who saw themselves and saw the Black Panthers in them, and they formed the Black Panther Party there. The Black Panthers of the United States saw a connection. Huey Newton saw a connection. Angela Davis has always been connected. So there was always the connections, but we saw an opportunity to renew those energies, and that renewed energy and that renewed tension. I couldn't imagine a better moment to go to Palestine than then, and to learn and to study and to share.
Thank you. No, absolutely. And I mean, the state violence has become, the connections of state violence have become much and much more similar and more apparent with videos, with social media. I mean, we've seen the killing of George Floyd on camera. We've seen the killing of a number of Black Americans on camera. We've seen the killing of Ahmed Arikat, the shooting, he accidentally rammed his car into a checkpoint and was shot 7 times. And you look at all these images and, this is at the top level, the similarities are so apparent. And I think there's a number of layers even, below that in terms of policies and in terms of segregation history. In terms of, the funding for cities, like I mentioned with Mohammed, and know how much Palestinian residents get. And a study was done in the US recently with EdBuild, where it was found that non-white communities received $23 billion less in funding than white communities. So this is state violence as well, but I do want, there is a question that's related to this that has been posted that I want to bring up, and which is talking about how the movements, and we'll start with Mohammed, with Sheikh Jarrah, and then you, Marc, can add to it, how these movements of liberation and struggle and uprisings have actually been vilified So it's not just that there's a state violence that exists that causes these uprisings, but actually the riots and the uprisings against the state violence have further been vilified, where the protesters are actually accused of inciting violence. And we just saw this recently in 1948, Israel, 2 days ago, has begun like a swamp of arrests by looking at, you know, videos of Palestinians who participated in the protest under the pretense of damaging property and looking for the videos and going out and arresting them. And so I would like, Mohammed, for you to shed light on how these incidents have been vilified by the state in Jerusalem, and then also Marc to also talk about that.
I think, Kenny, for as long as I've lived, I've noticed a discrepancy in between violence that is in a uniform that uses official language and then violence of people who are unorganized or not recognized officially. So for example, in Sheikh Jarrah, the state could throw skunk water into our homes, could throw stun grenades into my window while I'm teaching a class, could go inside my neighbor's house and literally break his leg and then come back the next day and break his leg, and then shoot a rubber-coated bullet at 15-year-old Jenna Kiswani in her back and break her spine. In Eled, a settler can collude with the state and kill a Palestinian and then have and be protected by the state. On Lions Gate, a settler can run through a group of Palestinians and then be protected by the state. In the Gaza Strip, the Israeli state could carpet bomb roads leading to hospitals, electricity, blah, blah, blah. Like the examples of state violence are endless, yet when a person wants to throw a rock or a rocket, then that becomes unacceptable. And it's not foreign to the history of colonialism, where like the colonized are seen as these primitive people who are not allowed to use violence. And the colonizers are allowed to use organized violence against them. But it also says a lot about our own responses as a traumatized people and our allies. I think over the years since the 60s, since the hijacking of planes, and now we have been in the business of humanizing the Palestinian cause too much. We have done too much to illustrate ourselves as perfect victims. This is something I have seen in the years that I've studied in the United States. When there's a victim of police brutality, there's so much done to illustrate that victim in a harmless light, in an angelic light. And there's the venomous questions of what was he doing? What was he holding? Did he resist? And blah, blah, blah. And all of these things. And these things exist also within the Palestinian liberation struggle. And it has kind of muzzled us. Now, my personal view is, I don't care if a person was just standing and putting their hands in their hoodie and got shot by the police, or if a person was waving with a knife at the police. No one should be killed by the state, period. Yet we have allowed the bullying, the muzzling, to kind of shift our position on this and pick and choose which martyrs, which victims of police brutality, which victims of state violence do we assert and uphold and mourn and make icons, and which we kind of talk about in quiet whispers and we neglect. I think in our movement, in the Sheikh Jarrah movement, when we started it, I was in New York, and 2 months, four or five months before that, I was in Atlanta when the George Floyd murder happened, and I was inspired by how much the ceiling was raised on the rhetoric of Black liberation. There were mainstream calls for abolishing the police. People were setting police cars on fire. People were writing essays in defense of riots. It was not uncommon or unorthodox to defend yourself and defend people's right to resist state violence. And I think that moment in Black American history really was one of the elements that readied the world for the conversation about Palestinian liberation. I think it's unprecedented, not the mainstream support for the Palestinian cause, but the fact that the conversation has gone from a conversation about human rights and protecting Palestinians against human rights violations to a conversation about Palestinians' right to liberation, Palestinians' right to resist their oppressors. And I think these articulations that have been inspired by the Black resistance movement and by other movements across the globe have helped people understand this so-called conflict as a very simplistic one rather than a controversial one. We have finally, I think, after years and years and years of watered down, sanitized language, finally started addressing the disease instead of the symptom and saying that as long as there is a regime that oppresses us, that dehumanizes us, that shoots to kill, that exploits the law to ethnically cleanse and ethnically displace people, then we are going to have a cycle of dehumanization. And when we address that, there's not going to be any more victims. That's the first thing. And then very briefly, I'll say that the second thing is people are more likely to stand in solidarity with you and work with you when you are in a position of power. When you're not asking people for pity or sympathy, you're asking people to support you in your plight for justice because you would be supporting your own self against your own fascists when you're standing with the Palestinian people's plight for justice. And I think the idea that we were able to articulate this in a way that says, yes, our homes are being taken, yes, our people are getting bombed, but we stand firmly in our persistence and our belief that we have a right to resist, we have a right to protect our communities, has motivated people to work with us and work for us. And I think that's the essence of the movement we're seeing today. And I'm very proud, you know, of the worldwide support. And I hope it continues. To anybody listening, I hope you're planning your next protest.
Marc?
I agree.
Well, let me phrase it differently for you then.
There's an interesting way that I mean that's a space that we definitely see parallels, right? I mean when I think about the way that our resistance is policed, the way that our resistance is managed, it creates an impossible set of circumstances. The only acceptable response to occupation, to state violence, to settler colonialism, to ethnic cleansing, is to remain silent as they kill you. Anything other than that is seen as an improper or inappropriate response. You know, mm-hmm. When we were in Ferguson, or when we were in Minneapolis, like this past year, and by we I mean just Black folk and people who are resisting, you know, they said, "Oh, you're breaking stuff. Oh my God, they're breaking windows." Right? Again, to Mohammed's point. The damage that is done on one side is met by an extraordinary and even disproportionate, both at the ethical level and at the level of international law, response by the powerful, and people are only policing the behavior of the power of the disempowered. So, and to give you a concrete example of that, you know, if we break the windows of a Target department store in the United States, yeah, they have to rebuild Target. This is a multi-billion dollar company that has investments everywhere. They also, you know, these big box retailers also exploit labor. They do far more harm to poor people. They do far more harm to the environment, far more harm to workers' rights, far more harm to local economies than anything we could do with rocks or bricks. But we all, and on the night where people decide to break into a store, or to break a store window, and I'm not saying they should or shouldn't, that's not the point of this conversation. But at the moment that they do that, they are responding to a much deeper, more powerful, and more pervasive form of state violence that doesn't get critiqued, right? But that would be bad if that were the whole story. But when we say hands up, don't shoot, they say it's improper. When we run from the police, they say, oh, well, we shot Walter Scott in the back because he ran. If he hadn't run, he wouldn't have gotten shot. Eric Garner stood still and they killed him. George Floyd didn't move an inch once he was on the ground. It didn't stop Derek Chauvin from continuing to keep his knee on his neck until he died. And so there's no acceptable response from the state that is seen as proper. And when Palestinians resist, there's a long history of Palestinian resistance. Some of it has been nonviolent, some of it has not been nonviolent. The Arab revolts begin in April of 1936. From April of 1936 to October of 1936, it's a general strike. It's a nonviolent form of resistance. It wasn't as if the British or the Yishuv at the time or anybody at the time said, oh, let's come up with a solution. Here's a nonviolent general strike. That's not what happened. When there is a boycott, they say Palestinians shouldn't be boycotting. Mm-hmm. It's unethical. The boycott is wrong. When BDS forms as a full-fledged movement, they say, oh my God, BDS is wrong. Even here in the United States, we have laws on the books and that are being drafted as a means of stopping people from engaging in BDS and protecting companies and states from such action. And so if you're saying that throwing a rock is wrong, and you're saying that BDS is wrong, if you're saying that violent resistance is wrong, you're saying that nonviolent resistance is wrong, then what you're saying is we want you to be quiet and just die.
Oh, absolutely.
And that's the truth. But I want to be very clear. An occupied people has a right to defend itself. I don't want to, and this was the point I was making in the UN speech. I believe in nonviolence. I think nonviolence should be our response. But we cannot create a narrative of nonviolence that ignores the fact that every people has a right to self-defense. Every occupied people has a right to defend itself. And so we can talk tactics, we can talk about international law, we can talk about what's ethical and what's not, but at the core, there is an attempt to disarm and disempower Palestinian people in the very same way that there's an attempt to disarm and disempower and silence Black people and all oppressed people around the globe. And so when I think about those parallels, I think that's a big one, right? Is that there's the pretext of saying, no, we don't mind if you protest, we just want you to protest the right way. But I have yet to find a form of Palestinian resistance that the powerful have said, oh, that's cool, you should do that, right? In the same way that I have yet to find a form of Black resistance that the powerful have said, okay, this is acceptable. And when I say the powerful, to be clear, I'm talking about nation states. I'm talking about those who are able to determine who lives or dies. I'm talking about those who are able to dispense funds. I'm talking about those who are able to draw policies, to create legislation. I'm talking about anybody who has a disproportionate impact on how we navigate our lives. If you're in power, you don't want to give it up. And so there's no difference here. And so I think that becomes part of how we find common ground here. We're beginning from a place of saying, consensus is not going to get us there. Public approval from the powerful is not going to get us there. We cannot wait until we get permission to resist. We cannot wait until our resistance is sanctioned. We cannot wait until somebody says that you're doing it right, good job, go ahead, you know, go get free. That's never going to happen for anybody who's oppressed around the globe.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, it's one thing that I'm reminded of is this post that I saw actually from what you're talking about, because whatever Palestinians or Black people or oppressed groups do, not just in terms of methods of resistance, but even in terms of the way that they voice their resistance, even by trying to be, you know, sensitive or in whatever, however, shape or form you fight, there is always an attack. And whatever you say, like I could say, oh, I was beaten up by an Israeli soldier. And it's like, the pointing is, well, you deserved it. You did right. Something. And so it reminds me of just recently during the war in Gaza, where I'm going with this, is there's this beautiful image, beautiful, I mean, by photography, that was actually taken by a Palestinian photographer, where he shot the sky where the Hamas rockets are going up and the Iron Dome is firing, right? So it's this like, these two powers in an image that are captured. And it's very symbolic of, you know, Israel having this Iron Dome, multi-million dollar Iron Dome that is protecting its citizens against Hamas $1,000 rockets. So this one guy on LinkedIn puts a post on there and says, this image shows exactly how the Palestinians are attacking Israel while Israel is only defending itself. So he rephrased the whole image and what it means. And this you know, the ability of the oppressor to sort of constantly try to bring us down is, you know, is uncanny. But there is something with the Black Lives Matter movement that has happened, that has not happened with Palestinians, is that it did create a wave in the US. And much more people, you know, more and more people have realized that the status quo has to change. Change is still progress. The conviction of Chauvin is not justice. Justice is that George Floyd is not killed or the likes of him in the first place, absolutely. However, there's definitely a shift that has happened in the US, at least in conversations, and at least in moving towards it. That as a Palestinian living in Palestine, and you know, I can't say that I see the same thing in terms of world solidarity.
That's so fascinating, Dana, because I'm inclined, and this might just be how oppressed people look at circumstances. I'm looking at it from my vantage point and seeing the opposite, right? So I mean, I am very inspired by, and I'm curious to know what Mohammed thinks about this, right? I'm very inspired by the movements of the last, say, 7 years here in the States. Black Lives Matter is something people are saying. It's something that everybody from politicians to companies are affirming, all true. We have police body cameras now, et cetera. But if we're talking about radical demands, like the type of demands that get us free, we're talking about not reform, we're talking about revolutionary change, we're talking about abolition, right? Not even just defunding, but abolition. We're saying, what does it mean to have a world without police and prisons? And I feel like moderate Democrats have been able to co-opt the radical discourse and make it such that we think we're doing something radical when we're actually just chipping away at the edges. Conversely, I remember even when I first started visiting Palestine, until the conversations I'm hearing now here in the United States, people were still very much believing that a two-state solution was possible. But it seems like, given the extreme authoritarianism or the naked authoritarianism that Netanyahu has demonstrated, along with his sort of bromance with Donald Trump, along with Donald Trump taking any pretense of commitment to a two-state solution, which I believe in a single one-state secular place in all of historic Palestine. But for those who believed in that, it's harder to believe in that now, partly because of how bad things have gotten, right? When Trump moves the embassy to Jerusalem, the US embassy, violating international law, when he cuts funds in UNRWA, when he attempts to make a kind of final status decision about Jerusalem and the question of right of return, at the same time that he sort of recognizes the Golan, that area in the Golan as Israel's, despite, again, contravening international law, he's made it so that almost no one thinks a two-state solution is viable, along with settlement expansion continuing the entire time here, right? Mm-hmm. Even what we see along the basin now in Jerusalem, right? I mean, it's part of what makes the Sheikh Jarrah thing so complicated, right? Is that it's very simple in the sense that this is ethnic cleansing and illegal transfer of people out of an occupied area. But when you look at the urban plan that's happening in Jerusalem, all of from Silwan to Isawiyah to Sheikh Jarrah, what we see is a very interesting set of arrangements that makes it very clear that a two-state solution is impossible. And so, and for the first time in the United States, I'm hearing people say, wait a minute, what's happening in Gaza is awful, right? They're not just saying Israel has a right to exist, Israel has a right to defend itself, who cares about those Palestinians? We're watching disproportionate force being used. We're watching people inside of Aqsa during Eid be attacked by police. And people are saying, we have to do something different in Palestine than anything we've ever talked about before. And so from my vantage point, I'm actually super optimistic about the possibilities of a whole different mode of thinking about Palestine post-Oslo, for the first time since Oslo, maybe. Whereas in the United States, I'm still hopeful. I believe that we're going to win. But I'm watching our work be co-opted by liberals in a way that I find very, very frustrating.
Wow. That's I mean, I see the two vantage points and I can see how your work would be co-opted. I don't think, I mean, I want to bring Mohammed into this conversation. He has lived also both in the US and, you know, in Palestine. And I want to see, and ask him, Mohammed, like, what, you know, what do you see as the Palestinian struggle and as the Black struggle? And where are we at as Palestinians in terms of our movement?
I think it's been, what's been very inspiring about this movement is that it's been a true, at least until now, until the past week, it's been a true reflection of what the Palestinian street wants and what the Palestinian youth wants. It hasn't been co-opted by NGOs yet. It hasn't been co-opted by retired politicians yet. It hasn't been co-opted by those people who will go on TV and talk about us and just say we just want equal rights and we just want to live and blah, blah, blah. It's been a clear message that we want liberation. And in that message, I've also been able, along many others, we've been able to expose the red herring of the Israeli propaganda machine. Since its inception, there has always been this talk about Israel's right to defend itself. Even like in the language, you know, there's Operation Protective Edge. This last one was something Shield. Their army is called Israeli Defense Forces. And it's very similar to the American Empire, right? Like it's very similar. But when you look at the history of both of these entities, their wars have never been fought on their so-called soil. They have never been defending themselves to begin with. There is no power dynamic in which Israel is defending itself. And we are finally able, as Palestinian youth, to call a spade, to say, no, I'm not even going to affirm this. I'm going to call this out as a red herring, as a distraction of what's happening on the ground. And I'm going to expose you as an aggressor, which is something that the generation before us have been silenced in trying to do or have not done so in before. So I think if we're able to keep this momentum in terms of the language, if people are able to be loyal to the Palestinian street and what the Palestinian street wants, and are able to see through colonial language, see through official language, institutionalized violence, then sure, I think there is a lot of hope for the Palestinians. And I don't think that entails any unfortunate consequences. I think it's a beautiful, beautiful thing. But again, it takes a strong person, it takes a strong, brave person to realize and recognize that a difficult conversation with your family members, or a difficult conversation on national television, or a difficult conversation with your bosses is never going to be as difficult as the reality of colonial violence that Palestinians are subjugated to. When you're able to like call out the red herrings and call propaganda for what it is and call distractions for what they are. And you know, like there's been talks in the past few days about social media pogroms against Zionists. Mm-hmm. And when Palestinians are able to say like, no, that's bull, you know, that's not true. What's a pogrom is the settler lynch mobs that are like walking around Palestinian cities, historically Palestinian cities, killing, shooting Palestinians, brutalizing Palestinians, brutalizing anybody that looks Arab, chanting death to Arabs. We are seeing, I think that's one indication that I think there's hope for us. And I also think, you know, in Sheikh Jarrah, the world has been able to see through my camera, through my sister's camera, through the cameras of the youth, as well as the cameras of people. You know, there's, for example, here's an example. There's a guy named Dioni. He's a city councilman. He also just vandalized a mural that was painted on our door that said, welcome to the resilient Sheikh Jarrah neighborhood. And then he had the municipality, the occupation municipality, erase it under the pretense that it was anti-Semitic, a mural that says, welcome to Sheikh Jarrah. This man is also, responsible for rejecting the statistic of 94% of the Palestinian building permits that are submitted. This man also lives in a stolen Palestinian property in Sheikh Jarrah. When all of these, you know, acts of collusion and of collaboration are being are being exposed, the world realizes that when we say a settler state, an ethno state, we truly mean this. This is a people, regardless of anything, this is a people that go into the army at 18 years old, learn to dehumanize and brutalize Palestinians. I have seen it with my own eyes, have a personal vendetta against Palestinians, shoot to kill, shoot into people's homes. And then 2 years later, they take off their uniforms, but the genocidal rhetoric, the rhetoric of ethnic cleansing, the rhetoric of dehumanization sticks. And this is why you have them walking around with their rifles, with their pistols in Sheikh Jarrah, while we are under blockade today. And we're not allowed to enter into our homes even those of us who live there and whose IDs say that we live there, we're having a hard time walking into our homes, whereas settlers can just walk in with their rifles. Now, when the world is able to see this, we have kind of bypass the gatekeeping of the New York Times, of Washington Post, of all the media outlets that call this a conflict, that refuse to reflect the truth objectively, that continue to like hijack the narrative under the guise of neutrality when really they're advancing Israeli bias. We are able to like escape that gatekeeping. And within that escape, all of this becomes super easy to digest. All of this becomes super. And so the idea of a one state, one Palestinian state becomes feasible because people understand that this oppression is not that nuanced, it's not that complicated, and it's above all, it's unacceptable.
Absolutely. And I think, you know, I think the three of us here agree that the idea of a two state, even though some people may still call for it, but the idea of two states is no longer viable. I mean, the facts on the ground do not allow for it. The settlement there's neither the geographies nor the place nor the policies nor any of it actually allow for it. And it would, you know, to have for people listening who may not be familiar with the one state or two state, the two state is basically having the West Bank and Gaza that is completely detached, and the West Bank is actually the majority of it is settlements, Israeli settlements. So we've become enmeshed. There are a number of questions coming in about, which all around the same theme is, what can people in the diaspora do? What can both Palestinians and allies, what can be done to keep this momentum, to keep this moving forward? And what would be the next steps? And maybe, you know, being also sort of illuminated by the Black Lives Matter, even though Marc thinks that we think that we still have way more work to do. I think we both have a lot of work to do. But what can be done for actual actions for people in the diaspora?
I want to defer to Mohammed on that, particularly thinking about, because the question for me is always, this is where I think allyship comes in, is because solidarity does not mean sameness. Mm-hmm. Our circumstances are different. Our conditions are different. Our needs are different. As we think about solidarity with Palestinians at this moment, you know, the thing that I've tried to do, particularly over the last month, although I've used my platform to bring Palestinians on and to use my voice when I can, but to kind of get out of the way and make sure that Palestinian voices are centered in the conversation, but also to ask, what do you need? So I guess my question now is the same. What do you need? How can we be allies to you? What is needed and what isn't?
I think this is, you know, a great moment for people everywhere, allies and otherwise, to reevaluate the language and the actions they use to be in solidarity with Palestinians. I think it would be an absolute betrayal to our hard work here on the ground to lower the ceiling. You know, I know that we have some prominent politicians talking about toning down the rhetoric. When the colonial violence that we're facing is not toning itself down. So I think I would ask people to actually bring up the rhetoric. I don't know if that's the actual phrase, but I think it's important to reevaluate the language you're using and align yourself with the voice of the Palestinian street and what the Palestinian street wants. And to be able to speak about this from a place of understanding the Palestinian self-articulation and Palestinian rights of self-determination and the Palestinian right to protection and resistance and all of those things. This means effectively that if I am calling on you to pressure your governments to sanction Israel, then you should pressure your governments to sanction Israel. And it shouldn't happen when people are getting bombed, and it shouldn't happen after I lose my home. It should happen because the existence of a settler colonialism is bad. Nobody should be getting colonized. I shouldn't be living as though I am in the wretched of the earth until I die. Like, that's not how I imagine that, like, I'm gonna grow old. I don't need to continuously live in those draconian, Kafkaesque realities that I've read about in school, that I've thought to be long gone and extinct, and then boom, I'm at Qalandia, and all of this colonial violence institutional is, you know, materialized in the cement blocks and in the soldiers looking at you with vengeance. I think it's really important to bring up the ceiling, like to raise up the ceiling on this, and to listen. Like, it's not the discourse of human rights doesn't work by itself. The discourse of apartheid doesn't work by itself. None of these things work by themselves unless you're calling for Palestinian liberation, unless you're calling this settler colonialism. I think materially also people need to be protesting in general. And I think, you know, when the George Floyd murder happened, we were organizing with like my friends in Atlanta, and I remember we did a protest in front of Kemp's mansion, the governor of Atlanta, whatever. And I remember people like brought the Palestinian flags, and I told them like, no, we're not doing this today. And I think for the Palestinians that are listening, it's really important. If we're expecting people to show up for us, if we're expecting people to be in solidarity with us, that we be in solidarity with these people materially also, to uplift their voices and not co-opt their own movements. I saw some like Palestinian Lives Matter stuff going around a few days ago. And I think it's really important to, you know, keep the intimate differences alive, and to respect those intimate differences, and to be there for one another as communities, not only to uphold a long-standing tradition of Black Palestinian solidarity, but to also understand that when you're helping other people fight against the fascism and the subjugation that they are faced with, you're effectively helping your own liberation. When Palestinians stand with indigenous communities that are almost erased by the American settler colonialism, when people stand with people in the global south who are almost erased by American empire violence, then you are working for your own Palestinian liberation, because all of these things are interconnected. And I would add, it's not enough to boycott settlement products. I would advise everybody to boycott all Israeli products, because what they're doing is foul and it shouldn't be tolerated. And it's not, you know, there's no disparity in geography and there's no disparity in the economy. It's all the same economy. And I think it's important to make that distinction, that people in Lid, in Palestine 48, people in Gaza, people in Ramallah, in the so-called West Bank, people in Jerusalem, in Sheikh Jarrah, in Silwan, are all facing different forms of the same colonial violence. Sorry, that was a rambling ask question.
No, that was a great answer.
No, that was awesome.
This is what we wanted.
That was awesome. And actually that brought in more questions. Is asking, and I do want to touch upon this, because Marc has gone through this, and, you know, through what happened with CNN, is that, you know, there are a couple of questions about people who are organizing in the US do face repercussions. Whether they face repercussions from their jobs, whether we've heard of professors who've been fired from their jobs, you've been fired from your job, Marc. So what do you say? I mean, one of the questions is like, how can we continue to organize even though there's this fear of censorship and this fear of, you know, the price we have to pay? And I know that, you know, we as Palestinians who live in Palestine, the price we pay is the occupation and the fighting, but we do have to, you know, be mindful of these people, the allies and people in the diaspora. So what would you say to them, Marc? What would your answer be?
It's a great question. The first thing is I don't have any quote, any advice, there's nothing I can say to allay all of your fear. I can't promise you that everything is going to be all right. You know, they say everybody want to go to heaven, don't nobody want to die, you know, it's like this.
If you believe in heaven, but
right. Exactly. Right. And there's a way that, which is actually part of the point too, right? Some people say they do. Then it's like, if you believe that much, you shouldn't be afraid to die, right? If you believe in liberation that much, you shouldn't be afraid to pay the cost. Mm-hmm. This work comes at a cost, it comes at a price. And the idea that we can get free without losing jobs, without being smeared, without being misrepresented, without being mischaracterized, I can't promise anybody that. If you're committed to Palestinian liberation, if you're committed to queer liberation, if you're committed to trans liberation, whatever the project is, if it's a righteous one, you're going to get hit really hard and really often. And the only thing that I can tell you is that when we have solidarity, when we have a buildup in numbers, when we have comrades who are working with us, it makes those hits a little more bearable. But you cannot fight for Palestinian liberation and not be smeared as anti-Semitic. You cannot fight for Palestinian liberation and not be called a hater. You cannot, it's impossible. That doesn't mean that we can't be self-critical, right? We have to fight and eliminate anti-Semitism from all sectors of our lives. It's in the same way we have to eliminate all forms of racism, in the same way we have to eliminate all forms of inequality and injustice. We gotta do that work. So, but we can't think that we can give the perfect quotes and do the perfect organizing strategy and do the perfect, write the perfect books and give the perfect sound bites, and no one will ever say you're promoting violence. No one will ever say that you're anti-Semitic. No one will ever say that you're a bad person. These things are going to happen. You're going to lose jobs. You're going to lose friends. You're going to lose networks if you do anything for liberation of any oppressed people. And so I no longer try to make people feel like there's a proper way to do this to avoid that stuff. And instead, I want them to feel braced and prepared and poised to withstand those hits that are going to come, because that's the work that needs to be done. Now, we can be both ethical and tactical, right? We want to make sure that we're not smuggling in, you know, anti-Blackness or transphobia or whatever the thing might, Islamophobia, whatever the thing might be, or anti-Semitism. We got to make sure we're not doing that. And we also have to be tactical with our language so that the entire, so that our work doesn't become a distraction, right, to the bigger project of freedom. But ultimately, we have to be obsessed and focused on freedom. And if you're a person who will fold under pressure and apologize and send out a tweet, or do, for example, just speaking for example, you know, when the pressure comes, you not only undermine your work, but you delegitimize the work of people who are righteously fighting for that struggle. So for example, if I am deploying the language of Palestinian liberation, and then I tweet the language of Palestinian liberation, and then I apologize for tweeting the language of Palestinian liberation, I am not only covering my own butt, but I am also now doing harm to the struggle for Palestinian liberation, because I'm now using my big bully pulpit to delegitimize your language. So when anyone else does that, it becomes a problem. You know, and I'm speaking in general terms. And so, and so I think that also, if you're going to be so afraid of being smeared, so afraid of being misrepresented, and again, it's going to happen, I can't say that enough, that you're going to not only back away from a principal position, but also drag everyone else under the bus with you, mm-hmm. then don't start. Just say nothing. Now, I want to be very clear, because I don't say this from any tactical or political high ground. There have been moments where I have made the mistake of thinking that people were operating in good faith, where I have said, you know, if this harmed you, then I apologize, but this shit is still right. Mm-hmm. But even that can get co-opted and misused. And so you have to, we have to stand the ground and not yield the moral high ground to people who are not looking for consensus.
And there's, I mean, no liberation movement in the history of movements did not have losses of lives, losses of jobs, imprisonment. So if the price to pay is that I am going to be kicked out of a job, then I'll go and find another one, right? I mean, there are ways around it. This is, you know, while people here are fighting to keep their lives, putting your job at risk, as long, I'm not saying go jobless, but you can find alternative ways to find it. And I can say that as a Palestinian here and as a Palestinian in the US. It's not the end of the world if you lose a job. We've seen how this happens with, you know, professors and academics who are Palestinians who've spoken on Palestine, and they're still doing fine. You know, they've found an alternative.
We'll fight and defend them because it's principled and because it's part of the broader political project of saying that we don't want people to be isolated when they defend Palestine or whatever the issue might be, right? However, like, how ridiculous would it be for me to publicly cry about losing a corporate media job when there are Palestinians who can't return to their homes, who, you know what I mean? I mean, people who are dying every day, people going through the ritual humiliation of checkpoints, people who are bordered by land, air, and sea and don't have access to potable water. How much can I lament losing a real, and it was a cool job and I loved the job and getting fired in public sucks. It's embarrassing, you lose money, you lose all this shit. It's not fun. But, and I was grateful for the solidarity I received and the support, but at the end of the day, that's a drop in the bucket in comparison to what Palestinians are facing and losing every single day. How dare I complain about that?
Mm-hmm. Can I add something to this?
Yeah, please. So, you guys are fine with going a little bit over time?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. Just wanted to check in with you. Yeah. So for everybody listening in, we are going a bit over time. So feel free to stay on. Go ahead, Pam.
Yeah, no, thank you. I'm happy to go over time. I'm very glad and honored to be here. So a lot of us in Sheikh Jarrah have been pretty visible in the media over the past few weeks, pretty visible. And I've been getting a lot of text messages, I hope you're safe, may God pray, I pray for your safety, blah, blah, blah. And then me and my friends will make jokes about assassinations. And, you know, Ghassan Kanafani was assassinated by the Mossad with his niece in Lebanon. And we joke about this, right? And sometimes it gets to me, sometimes it gets to my, you know, other people. Yesterday, a man, a Palestinian man, 23 years old, exactly as old as I am, was walking in Ramallah, and he was assassinated by Mustaribin, who are an Israeli special unit, who are disguised as Palestinians, but they're Israelis and they're disguised as Palestinians, and they usually carry out arrests or executions. And he was executed extrajudiciously. A few hours after, the Israeli police said that he was killed by mistake. Now, what does that meant for me is that, like Audre Lorde says, your silence will not protect you. Like, doesn't matter if you're on CNN talking about American Empire being a terrorist nation, or if you're in your home huddled up and waiting for the storm to pass, you're always at risk of dying by colonial violence. Mm-hmm. You're never safe. And that's the situation in Palestine. So like Marc said, to put that in context, losing a Thanksgiving dinner or a job is minuscule in comparison to that. And I think people should remind themselves of that. And I also think, this is just my personal belief, if you're getting accused of whatever form of bigotry, and you know you haven't committed it, you should double down on your initial stance if it's a righteous one. Because like Marc said, when you apologize for righteousness, then you are betraying that righteousness, and you are betraying the people that count and rely on your righteousness.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So there is, Marc, there is a question that got a lot of votes, and I think it's for you. So, and I think we should address it because it's an important question to address privilege. And the question is that most Palestinians cannot enter Jerusalem. So can we, the question says, can we address the privilege of coming, being a non-Palestinian and visiting, you know, the homelands of people who cannot enter themselves. So I would like you to address that.
Yeah, you know, it's an interesting question. I have, in the times that I've traveled to Palestine, many times, other than my initial entry point, I've been intentional about avoiding normalization. So I've always traveled through the Jisr. I've always come through Amman. I've never wanted to enjoy the privilege of going through Ben Gurion, but also not wanting to normalize. Mm-hmm. When I travel to Jerusalem, I only travel into, I only stay in East Jerusalem, usually in Sheikh Jarrah, sometimes with friends in the old city. I only buy from Palestinian businesses. And I'm largely there to learn, to study, and to work. I have, in my conversation with Palestinian people about how they would desire American comrades to travel, that's what I've been told is the proper way and what people would prefer to happen. Mm-hmm. But the idea of not entering Palestine at all, or at least Jerusalem at all, because so many people have been pushed out of Jerusalem and into other areas, is an interesting one. I've never been confronted with that question or that possibility that it might be bad allyship or improper to go to Jerusalem. I think it's not for me to decide, and so I'd be open to feedback, more feedback from Palestinians about what's proper, and I'd be happy and willing to do whatever. I think, but it becomes a bit of a challenge, right? Do you not go to Lid? Do you not go to, you know, I could think of, villages in 48 where I might be attempting to do some organizing work, but people were cast out, right? Do I just go to the camps? Do I just go to the West Bank? You know, there are people in the West Bank who are being pushed out. If the argument is you shouldn't go where Palestinians are being treated unjustly, Palestinians are treated unjustly everywhere. So then the question becomes, what does allyship look like for Palestinians? What are the strategic places I can go? I'd be willing to defer. I will defer to Palestinians on what that looks like. But to answer the question directly, I've never, honestly, the Jerusalem question has never been posed to me. And when I speak to people in Jerusalem, in East Jerusalem, my sense is that that's not what's being asked of me.
I wanted to put it there because it did get a lot of votes and people, you know, wanted to hear about it. But I do want to point out that even within Palestinians, there are privileges. So I am a Palestinian with the West Bank ID. So I cannot enter Jerusalem. Currently, I'm in Ramallah. I have not been able to set foot in Jerusalem because doing so would require a permit from the Israelis. So Muhammad, for example, is more privileged, so to speak, privileged being in quotes, that he is able to go between Ramallah and Jerusalem as he pleases while I'm not.
Right.
However, somebody from Gaza is not even able to enter the West Bank. They're not even able to leave Gaza. So does that mean that I don't go around Ramallah and the West Bank because I am more privileged than somebody from Gaza? Absolutely. I don't know. Absolutely not. And also, you know, as a Palestinian with a Palestinian ID, West Bank, I'm able to cross the borders back and forth so far with no problems, no trouble, because I'm a Palestinian. While a Palestinian American or a Palestinian British get stopped for 5-6 hours and are at a much higher risk of being denied entry. So I think as long as one acknowledges their place of privilege, I don't think being an ally or you know, in solidarity needs to stop just because one is more privileged than the other, as long as there's an acknowledgement of that privilege. This is what I think. I don't know, Muhammad, if you want to add something to that.
Yeah, to quote a very famous Zionist saying, I think you should visit Palestine. I think there's I think there's amazing communities, amazing people that are working really hard. You know, Israel has made it its mission to structure any visit to occupied historic Palestine to be in favor of Israel using, you know, propaganda, using colonial geographies that will kind of force you as a tourist to never even encounter the reality of the occupation. Yep. But if you're curious about Palestine and you're a tourist, you can be smart about it and support Palestinian economies. I wanna give a shout out to one of my favorite organizations in Palestine. I actually have their book just by chance because I was using their glossary. There's an organization in Jerusalem called Grassroots Al-Quds. And their entire work is, working to map and organize and mobilize Palestinian communities and Palestinian economies and help tourists who want to be ethical tourists here within colonial Palestine to uplift Palestinian voices and uplift Palestinian economies and give them an experience that really highlights the realities and the fragmentations and, the actual material manifestations of ethnic cleansing and settler colonialism here. They have a book called Wujud that you can buy that kind of gives you an example of where to go, where to sleep, where to eat, where to buy. But it also gives you all of the political context about Isawiyah, about Sheikh Jarrah, about Silwan, about anywhere and everywhere in Jerusalem and occupied Jerusalem. So I do think actually we need people to come here and uplift our economy. You just have to be ethical about it and you have to be smart about it. If you're coming here as an ally, then you should just be intentional with your tourism. I don't think it's a betrayal to the Palestinian people that you're coming here and uplifting their economy and seeing things for what they are. I think the Dream Defenders delegation to Palestine didn't only change the Dream Defenders' lives, it changed my own life as a young Palestinian being visited by Black Americans in my home that was taken over by Israeli settlers. And I think there's so much merit in that delegation solidarities as well as ethical tourism within colonial borders. So I think to answer the question, Yani, I know Marc was being super nice, but I think you should visit Palestine.
I think we should, I mean, anybody who can and is able to visit should visit Palestine.
Anyone who can.
Definitely. There is a question that a couple of questions that have come in about the younger generations. And what are the tools for educating the younger generation and how do we include this history in schools and curriculum? And I'm talking here both on Black history and Palestinian history. How do we push for this to be more spread out amongst the younger generation that is coming up? Any ideas?
I'm not sure what you mean. Could you rephrase that?
Sorry, that was Siri on my Apple speaker, who apparently is Zionist and does not know what you mean. There is a that was the most bizarre thing.
That was bizarre, yeah.
I think the first thing I always tell students as a professor is don't let school get in the way of your education. You know, so there's a way that we have to be mindful that schools are institutions and their systems and their bureaucracies, and we have to navigate these systems successfully for lots of reasons, right? And so that might mean that while we want to invest in school and make school better, and make school more responsive to our histories, we also have to remember that oppressed people have always had to translate and transmit their own histories, right? Mm-hmm. So that means that the out of school spaces have to be important. Bookstores have to be important. When I'm in Jerusalem, I'm looking at educational bookshop as my education as much as I am, you know, Putz University, right? Or what have you. Here in the United States, I'm looking at community centers and churches and masajid and everything else in addition to what's happening in the school building to narrate our history, to tell the truths that we need to tell. At the same time, we need to change how we educate each other and teach each other about our struggles. One thing is to add more names and faces. That's the easy part, right? We need to add more names and faces to our history. There's no way that I can tell the history of America and not tell the history of Black inventors and Black teachers and Black organizers and Black activists. And to also at the level of intersectionality, not lose sight of the fact that women's voices always get hidden. Women's voices always get obscured. And so we have to be mindful of how we tell our stories. But it's not just enough to append or omit or add names and faces. It's also what stories do we want to tell? How do we want to frame America? Do we want to frame up even the language of discovery, right? When we talk about how the modern world was sort of developed, the language of discovery is imperialist language, right? Mm-hmm. Because none of this stuff is discovered, right? But the language of discovery and the discourse of discovery becomes a way to sanitize plunder and erasure and all these other forms of colonial violence. And so we have to not just say, oh, well, Black people were there too, or, oh, wait, Palestinians were already, in Jaffa or what have you. It's to reframe the conversation, to take back the language, to restructure the conversation, to ask different things. And that's not going to get you into Harvard or Yale. It may not get you to pass the Tojihi, right? But what it can do is get you free. And so that's why I say it shouldn't just be in school. It should be out of school, because schooling and education are different. And what we need is education. Schooling gives you some of that, but the real education is going to happen from the people.
Mm-hmm. Mohammed, do you want to add something to that? I want to add something after you add something. So
yeah, I'm not worried about the younger generations. I think TikTok University is going to educate everyone.
Exactly.
Khilak, I don't even have TikTok.
You should get it. I learned a lot.
No, I think also to build on that, I think more and more voices that write books, whether it's novels, whether it's children's books, whether it's history books, whether it's articles, voices from both movements, these things are also can be educational tools and used whether in universities, whether in schools. And this is one way that I think having more voices in terms of authors, whether Palestinian authors or Black authors being taught in curriculum is something that can be really effective. I mean, how many books have we all read that have stuck with us from elementary school, right, that were in the curriculum? And there's books that never leave you because this was like the basis of your education. And I think for Palestinian writers, it is imperative that they keep doing the work that they're doing to also get into that, to get into the education system. And there's also been a few questions about censorship of social media. It's a huge topic. By the way, I just want to let you guys know that, and people listening, that actually this webinar, when we try to promote it on Facebook and on Instagram, because usually as MIT AAA, we pay to promote our webinars, it was declined, it was rejected. we received the reasoning that it addresses social issues and political issues, which is not in line with Facebook and Instagram. I mean, I have the response. I've actually reached out to Hamle, which do the work, they're in 48, and they weren't able to get it. However, we did manage to get 2,000 registrations, and the post was shared numerous times, and we got more coverage than we would have ever gotten had we paid for the promotion, but it was censored. And there is, further censorship. So how do we deal with that?
That's a great question. And I wrote a book last fall with Mitchell, or this winter, I'm sorry, time is crazy. I guess it was 3 months ago. God, it feels like a million years ago. The book came out in February, called Except for Palestine. And mm-hmm. I tried to do a promotion on IG, Facebook, it got rejected every time. Every single time. I have not. It's like, I don't know. Maybe it's the font. I'm going to assume it's the font. Maybe they don't like my book cover color or something. I don't know. But they, it's been very challenging to watch so many people who have a principled position have their voices silenced, have their posts taken down. And part of it is that we have to organize it and use our voices and power to teach these social media companies that their position is not a tenable one. This isn't a mistake. Right? I'm not suggesting we have to teach them the issue so that they know that this isn't okay. No, they understand the issue, but we have to push back. We have to resist. I mean, that's a great question.
I mean, let's take for example the rejection of your posting or people's posts being brought down.
I think
that's been happening a lot.
I think that one's an easier one to fight, as well as, but I was actually going to start with the idea that any language critiquing Zionism can be taken down from Facebook. That was something that was proposed a few months ago. Mm-hmm. This is where, you know, politics make strange bedfellows, but sometimes these so-called free speech advocates, these First Amendment advocates who love to be able to say whatever they want, this is a moment where we have to draw attention to it through our media, through alternative outlets, to draw attention to Facebook's problem. Now, Facebook has the power to say, you know, we don't care what you think. But I think if we have critical mass of people who are willing to log off, a critical mass of people who are willing to relocate, a critical mass of people who are willing to spotlight this stuff, I think we can get a pushback. But the IG thing, I don't know about. You know, Mohammed's a much better organizer than I am. I'd be curious to know sort of what he thinks our options are for doing this. But I do think something can be done.
Mohammed?
Yeah, so I think, like, firsthand, when we did the Save Sheikh Jarrah campaign, my Instagram account got, like, on a daily basis, I would get messages that that your account might be deleted. My sister's account got deleted for like 24 hours. Hundreds of my posts were getting removed by Instagram in real time. I would be posting videos of police breaking into people's homes illegally, breaking their bones or whatever, and they would get deleted instantly off of Instagram. And we know that the head of Instagram was a former official in the Israeli so-called defense forces. So, like Marc said, we know that these people are well aware of what they're doing. There have been resistant tactics, like Hamle has been pressuring them. Also, I think Palestinian, like younger Palestinians, have decided to leave one-star reviews on Instagram and Facebook applications in the App Store. I'm not sure how effective is that, but I know it's working in terms of bringing down their rating. Maybe that gives them like a financial loss. I don't think I'm the best like tech savvy person to answer this question. I know that pushback works. Mm-hmm. And I also know that although our accounts were getting, you know, I've been like, so many people have tried to hack my account over the past 2 months. As I said, my account continues to get messages that it might be deleted. Some of my friends or people who organize with us have been targeted for supporting terrorism. But at the same time, in the matter of 1 month, I now have 500. No, what is that? I don't even know how to say the number. I have 500,000 followers on Instagram in the matter of 1 month. My sister has 1 million. In the
Mark is like, how?
I'm impressed.
Yeah, so like, as much as there is censorship, there's a clear global thirst for an articulation of Palestinian reality that is not censored. And social media giants are well, well aware of that. So I think that people will find their way to the truth no matter the censorship. So I'm very hopeful, and I'm not intimidated by the censorship. I think it's a storm that will pass, and I know that the people, like the tech nerds, will take care of it for me. I'm not gonna
And if something gets taken down, you know what? Post it again. If your account gets closed, open another one. I mean, another issue we faced with the MIT AAA a few months ago is we were doing a walk for water for Gaza with a nonprofit in the US. And again, when we tried to promote it, it was rejected. So I put on a post and said, this was rejected. Please let us do this the old fashioned way. They disabled our promotions completely because of the post that I posted about it being rejected. The thing is, once I posted that, we managed to raise $5,000 in a span of a week just by people, even though they rejected the promotion where we get more viewers, just by finding alternative ways. I have a friend, here in Palestine, he's actually in Jerusalem, who wrote a beautiful article about what was happening in Sheikh Jarrah, like a post, and he got taken down after it was shared 200 times. So you know what he did? He had taken screenshots and he posted it again. And I think until we get to those people in positions of power to change their policies and to hold them accountable, we have to find creative ways to do it. And that would be my advice. We are half an hour over time. I would love for this conversation to go on much longer, but I do think we have to wrap up. I do want to there's one question, Marc, that I swear three people asked. Where can I get Marc's shirt?
So I don't even, this is going to sound really bad. So Uncle Bobby's, my bookstore sells Palestine t-shirts. If you go to unclebobbies.com, Uncle B-O-B-B-I-E-S.com, we have like four or five different ones. I don't remember, and this is going to sound really bad, I don't remember if we sell this one or if I got this one. I buy Palestine t-shirts everywhere I go. So I have like a closet full of them, and I wear them to faculty meetings just to make people angry. And so I don't remember where I got this one from. It might be on unclebobbies.com, but I'm not 100% sure. If it's not, then I don't know where I may have gotten it from. Existence is Resistance. It may have been Nancy Mansour, maybe. That might be it as well.
Well, once you find out, I think you should do a post where you can get it. And you
I will do a post.
And so people can know where, because literally three people asked, where did he get it from?
That's so cool. I am certain. I've never been more certain than I am at this moment that we all will be free and that we all will be victorious.
Ahmed?
Yeah, thank you. I don't know what to say. Dana, thank you so much for moderating this and for all of your insight. And Marc, it's always a pleasure to hear from you. I appreciate you.
You're my brother.
Space, and I think if we're able to stay stubborn these coming months, we're gonna make some real changes. I'm very excited about the Ireland thing. I know it's, you know, it's not gonna liberate Palestine by itself, but you know.
It's steps. It's a journey. I say that always. I'm like, you know what? I may not see it in my lifetime, right. But you know what? It's a journey. You know, liberation struggles take, and this is one, you know, one thing I would like to say. I mean, look, again, I don't want to go back to the similarities because I think it's unique, but how long has the Black liberation movement been going on?
Exactly.
Much longer than the Palestinians. Much longer, and actually it's making strides. So I am somebody who's very optimistic and hopeful, even if it's not on the short term. And I want to really thank the two of you for this incredible conversation that is much, much needed. And I hope this will have many more of these, not just with MIT, but with other organizations and with other people to build these solidarity and links. So I really want to thank for all of you who joined us today. I do want to thank also Moana from MIT Alumni Association and Zain Al-Jisser from the MIT Arab Alumni Association for really working so hard to accommodate the influx of numbers that we got that went beyond our original allowance and license. And I want to thank all of you who participated today in our webinar series, and keep an eye out for our next session in the series, which will take place on June 15th. And from all of us at the MIT Arab Alumni Association, stay safe, goodbye, until we are liberated. Thank you.